All right. Thank you for coming to my talk, Computer Architecture, C++, and High Performance. We'll start by introducing the motivation for performance. Why do we care about it at all? What is it, and how can we measure it, reason about it, and improve it? So why? If we go back to 1965, to an article by Gordon Moore, we could see that there was a certain feature, an economics observation about the semiconductor industry. What was observed by Gordon Moore is that as the years passed, it was more and more economically beneficial to integrate more and more transistors on a chip. You could always increase the scale of integration before, you would just have to pay more for it. If you traced those sweet spots over time and connected the dots, you obtained a curve which looks like this, and it said initially that the number of transistors on a chip would double every year, which was later revised to doubling every 2 years. This has later became known as Moore's law, and to a large extent, the number of those chips, the transistors on a chip, translated to higher performance. Higher performance enabled us to accomplish more, to produce more featureful software, but also to have larger teams to maintain this software, often moving to higher level languages, abstractions which didn't always have zero overhead, sometimes coupled with a promise of just-in-time optimizing compilers that will become sufficiently smart any day now and will make C++ unnecessary. As we went forward in time, the transformation hierarchy was kept in the background. We started with a problem, translated this to an algorithm, implemented it as a program which passed through the hardware-software interface of the ISA, ran on a microarchitecture which organized the circuit that moved the electrons that done the actual work. And for many, many decades, starting from 1965, we have been living in phase one. All of those layers we have seen have been walled off. When you're solving a problem and you were thinking about complexity analysis of your algorithm, you weren't supposed to care about the lowly details of microarchitecture. The analogy we often kept hearing was that of a car and a car engine, and we know computers are completely like car engines, and you were never supposed to look under the hood, even if you were curious. And that has actually worked fairly well for many years. I think pipelining, caches, branch prediction, speculative execution, out-of-order execution, what all of these features had in common is that they did not require programmer attention. And in many ways, they improved the performance of a single-threaded CPU without any action. But that was until recently. We have observed that around 2003, the single-threaded performance of the CPU has begun to slow down in its growth rate. We still kept adding more and more transistors on the chip. However, the single-threaded performance was no longer growing because we hit the power wall and could no longer continue the frequency scaling. That doesn't mean the transistors were all wasted. The industry has instead switched to adding more cores on a single chip. In the meantime, as the processor speeds have become faster and the latency of the digital logic implementing the CPU architecture has been steadily declining, latency of memory hasn't made much progress. In fact, if we look at more recent years and look at the performance of main memory, which corresponds to looking at performance of DRAM technology, we can see that for over a decade now, latency of memory has stopped improving at all. We no longer have anything like faster memories. There is lots of promising new technologies, phase change memory, high bandwidth memory, hyper memory cube, white I/O. What all of them have in common is that they primarily target bandwidth, and they do not attempt to compete with DRAM, let alone with SRAM on latency. And even if we do get those high-performance, non-volatile memories, We could see what happens if we replace hard drives by them. One interesting benchmark is that of recursively searching a file system, perhaps to find a function in our big C++ application. And if we compare the bottlenecks in the hard drive-based system and the non-volatile memory-based system, we can see that previously, I/O latency has dominated the primary execution costs, while moving to emerging memory technologies, the main bottleneck is going to be system software, and moving from the user stack to kernel stack and back again. We can also see that other area of applications, which has often been said not to be CPU-dependent, databases, also suffers from a lot of stalls. They are not just memory stalls and cache stalls, but on an out-of-order superscalar CPU, many of these are just resource stalls where we spend most of the cycles waiting for the execution unit's availability and only do computation for a very small amount of time. Why is system call having an overhead which is growing in performance importance, and what does it have to do with caches? We can see that the performance loss of a system call can continue throughout thousands of cycles. Oftentimes, when we analyze this, we just look at timing. We look at time it takes to switch from kernel space to user space. We look at the time the context switch continues. And as we wait for the interrupt to reply, we once again look at the time it takes to switch from the kernel space driver software to the user space application. But this switching also means that we switch the instruction stream that is executing. And that implies that we also switch the state of caches that are utilized by the CPU running the given instruction stream. The same thing happens to branch predictions. The same thing happens to translation look-aside buffers. And in fact, it is these indirect costs, the utilization of CPU structures, that can take more than 50% of the execution time of a system call today. All of this is against the backdrop of a new trend that we haven't seen for a while, where the economic benefits of increasing the number of transistors on a chip and making them smaller have stopped, and we no longer have a decrease in costs. This has been observed by Intel and has resulted in a change of the product cycle, where before, each processor generation was making the feature size smaller and introducing new microarchitecture. Today, we have a third phase, which is optimizing what we have. Last but not least, we can care about performance because it is essentially currency. It enables us to add features to our software. If we have a software which is running fast, we are able to optimize it, benchmark it, and generalize it. But if it's running slow, we often first have to fix that problem. So what is performance, and how do we measure it? We can start with the early days, 200 BC, with the very first invention of matrix methods, later renamed Gaussian elimination. They were introduced and performed manually on a so-called counting board. And performance of this method was compared by counting the number of operations required to be performed on that board. If we go back to 1965, the same year that Gordon Moore has published his article, another interesting article was published on the computational complexity of algorithms. The problem it was trying to solve is that given that a sequence is computable by a Turing machine, how hard is that sequence to compute? And we can see that the answer boiled down to essentially looking at the number of operations required to be performed by that Turing machine as the problem size increased. And oftentimes, even though we don't have to, we write this algorithmic complexity in an asymptotic notation known as big O notation, which also takes the leading constants out of the equation and only leaves the rate of growth as the problem size increases. And when we are trying to pick an algorithm from the standard library and a container to use with this algorithm, we sometimes use it as a guide. For instance, we can say that find algorithm for a general container has to traverse the entire sequence, element by element, and compare with the value that we are searching for, hence resulting in a linear complexity. Alternatively, we could have a sorted container and use a binary search algorithm, which splits the sorted sequence into two halves and zooms in on the lower or upper half recursively until it finds the given number that we are searching for in a logarithmic amount of time. We can also make use of the fact that we have a container which maintains the invariant of being sorted and offers its own find member function, which promises logarithmic complexity as well. In order to compare performance in a scenario such as this, we can use scientific method, which means to observe the experiment's running time, try to see how it scales, and try to hypothesize about the behavior. We can track the running time as the problem size increases, and often we are able to recover the rate of growth of the algorithm by analyzing how the running time changes. We don't even have to forget about the leading constants, because algorithmic complexity never required looking only at the order of growth. For instance, we could use tilde approximation, which keeps the leading constants in. It's also quite easy to see that we can recover this by a simple doubling ratio trick. Essentially, if you double the problem size and the running time doubles as well, you have a reason to believe you have a linear complexity algorithm. However, if you double the running time, if you double the problem size and the running time quadruples, you have reason to believe you have quadratic complexity, and so on. So let's see if we can apply this to a simple example when we have containers like vector set, flat set from boost, and vector set from EASTL. We are going to generate a container which is going to contain numbers, unsigned integers 32-bit. We are going to put only odd numbers in that container. And then what we are going to do is to search for any random integer in this range. And we could do this just like such. When we write a test case manually, we carefully make sure to have print statements in every single operation that we would like to measure. We make sure to use a chrono steady clock to measure every single operation, and essentially couple the business logic with the timing instrumentation for every single operation. This is very manual, this is not very scalable, and it's not very useful. So what might be a better idea is to use a benchmarking library, an open source one, for instance, like Nonius, which allows us to be more automatic, which allows us to parameterize our test by the size of the problem, by the number of queries, and put this in an automated solution like continuous performance management system. We can also see that the code will become cleaner. We can now see the structure of generating the odd numbers. The code searching for a number now fits on one slide. It is not cluttered with any print statements. We can see that we have a container that we construct from the input values, and we indeed find a uniformly distributed random number in this container. Similarly, we can see that we have a specialization just for a vector. When for good measure we are even going to copy this vector, then we are going to sort the copy, and then we are going to use the lower bound. We are just trying to give the STD set a fighting chance here. We can also see that the test cases here are quite easy to understand. We can describe all of them with the names. We can accept the parameterized configuration of the benchmark that we are trying to run, either the size of the container, but also the number of the queries. And we can run a report, look at the statistics, automatically vary the problem size and queries, or just plot the results. And what is interesting to see is that even when we do all of that extra copy for the vector which is sorted and then searched through binary search using lower bound, we still outperform STD set by around 3 times. We can also scale the problem size, we can scale the number of queries, but we can see that even if we scale both, the ranking essentially doesn't change. So wherever were the small constants explaining the running times for the small problem sizes and small number of queries, those leading constants also scale up when we increase them. How can we understand this? How can we analyze what's going on? And how can we reason about this? First thing to take into account is that looking at the growth often assumes the analysis of the algorithm, the so-called random access machine, which means we can access the memory in random order and the time should be the same. And if this worked, then we should be able to see that as we scale the input size and we look at the running time, the order of growth should scale according to what the complexity theory tells us. However, for many popular and important algorithms like permutation, heap sort, or binary search, we can see that there is a significant deviation, and we actually pay more and more for the given problem as we increase the problem set. Asymptotic means here that we are having a large data, but this large data has to be brought in from memory, which means that looking only at computation complexity ignores the communication complexity. However, looking at any of them separately wouldn't make sense either, because the fundamental feature of modern CPUs is that they can overlap the latencies of communication and computation. And what is an operation? We can think of operations such as addition or multiplication and make it a double precision floating point operation. We can see that on a latest architecture like Skylake, we can do quite a lot of them in a single cycle. However, by looking at memory operations, we can see that we can only do a fraction of them in a cycle. So perhaps if we want to continue counting operations, disregarding memory is not a good idea. So what is the way to take those constants into account? And how can we explain the fact that the standard set find implementation can be 3 times as slow as the lower bound running on a sorted vector? Reasoning about performance requires us to understand what are the building blocks, the microarchitectural components of the CPU, which allows us to run experiments on this. If we look at the microarchitecture of a processor such as Skylake, we see that there is a lot of execution units, multiple ALUs, multiple vector units, multiple units allowing us to access memory. All of this is run by a branch predictor, which allows us to speculatively execute the instructions scheduled out of order. All of this is combined to enable parallelism on a pipeline level, instruction level, memory data, and thread. And because all of those parts are running together and are often interacting in surprising ways, it might be a good idea to look at them separately, see how they came about, what problems were they trying to solve, and what assumptions did they make. For instance, one of the earliest innovations in CPU architecture was pipelining, where we could introduce instruction processing in multiple stages, fetching, decoding, executing instruction, and writing back the results to memory, and you can break them down so that you can overlap those stages. This allowed you to execute one instruction while you were decoding another and fetching another one still. Now, given that you had those multiple execution units, like multiple ALUs, you could also go with a superscalar design, which allows you to have multiple execution stages running together. Another aspect that was introduced very early was a small high-speed buffer called the cache, which was solving a problem that we have seen already, namely the processor memory performance gap. The IBM System 360 Model 85 was a relatively fast CPU of an 18 nanosecond processor cycle, coupled with a very slow main memory, which had 1 microsecond cycle. So the idea was to introduce the cache, and the assumption behind this idea is that the programs would not be having random addressing patterns. If this assumption was satisfied, then the cache was quite effective and could hide the latency of accessing main memory for most of the times. Another innovation introduced in around the same time was out-of-order execution, which allowed us to make use of those multiple execution units that we have on a CPU. Instead of executing one operation after another, waiting for every single one to complete in sequential program order, we could execute them out of order and only wait for the results at the end. In order to do that, and in order to satisfy the dependencies required for instruction execution, we needed to introduce a structure called reservation station, which tracked the access of the operands needed to perform an operation. It also meant that we could utilize more of execution units if we took care of our code not introducing any unnecessary dependencies. For instance, instead of summing numbers to one register in a loop, we could unroll this loop and perform the operations on multiple registers at the same time. This technique was later called loop unrolling. And if we go back to the 1980s, one final missing piece was a way to have it all done on a CISC processor and support precise exceptions, so that when something went wrong, the program counter would reflect the execution state corresponding to instruction that actually caused the problem. The idea was to translate the instructions into simple micro-operations. We could then execute those micro-operations out of order, which corresponded to a data flow execution, where the only order that the execution stage itself had to follow was the availability of the operands. In order to have the results stored so that we can commit them at the end in program order upon successful completion, we need to introduce a small structure called a result buffer. Because the same problem was also solved for a pipeline processors, we now use the name, which is a reorder buffer, which is exactly the same thing. So now we can put all of those things together. We have a superscalar out-of-order processor, which takes our static program, possibly runs branch prediction to take care of control flow dependencies, and then executes our program, taking care only of data flow dependencies, reordering the instructions as it sees fit, and executing them completely out of order, and only committing them upon successful completion at the end in the original program order. We can see that this organization of a CPU begins to resemble the architecture that we have today. We know most of those structures also from programming. For instance, reorder buffer is nothing else but a circular FIFO, where it has the youngest instruction at the tail and the oldest instruction waiting to retire at the head. All of this didn't evolve overnight. It was driven by trade-offs. Some of those trade-offs were latency versus bandwidth. For instance, accessing memory at lowest latency was not possible to be done at the same time as accessing at the highest speed. We could see that, in fact, peak bandwidth performance of memory meant the highest latency, while the lowest latency of memory meant very slow bandwidth. So let's see how those trade-offs look in the example of a simple algorithm that we are going to run. For instance, consider going through a vector containing multiple numbers and summing them up. We could use one summation variable. We could use two summations variable. We can run our program at optimization level 2 and see that by using two summation variables in parallel, we indeed have a performance resulting in a code that is twice as fast. We can analyze the reasons behind this by using a program called perf. And the first thing that shows up is that the number of stalled cycles in the front end of the CPU pipeline is quite different between the summation 1 and summation 2 program. We can explore this even further by looking at the assembly code. By looking at the summation variable in the C++ code, we can see that it only utilizes one register, and it has a read after write dependency, so that every single iteration has to wait for the previous iteration to complete before it can begin. In contrast, by looking at summation using two variables, we can see that this C++ code is going to be translated into this assembly code, which uses two registers, XMM0 and XMM1, which can run in parallel. We can then utilize another program, which allows us to grow a little bit deeper into the reasons behind that, called Interarchitecture Code Analyzer. We can mark the code that we are interested in analyzing, run the YAKA program, look at the report, or very quickly just grab the results. And we can see that our loop, that is summing the results into the XMM0 register, has to execute one after another in sequential order. In contrast, if we look at the loop using two registers, XMM0 and XMM1, we can see that these two operations can be executed completely independently of each other in parallel. So we can explain this by looking at the length of the critical path and how many operations we can execute in parallel on that path. And parallelism is nothing else but the work divided by depth, which is the number of operations divided by the length of the longest critical path. If we are able to form two independent instruction streams that do not have dependencies that constrain them to be done one after another, then we can achieve instruction level parallelism. What prevents us from achieving full potential here are the read after write dependencies as well as control dependencies. The penalty depends on how expensive the operation that we are executing serially is, as well as how many operations can we execute in parallel to hide its latency. Whenever we don't execute all of the instructions that we put on a CPU, we waste the issue slots that we have. For instance, considering our summation example, if you only sum one register after another, clock cycle after clock cycle, we suffer from horizontal waste. But that's not the only kind of inefficiency we can have in a program. We could also have a branch miss prediction or a cache miss, which results in the vertical waste. The cache misses, branch miss predictions, and memory accesses all have in common the fact that they prevent us from achieving the full peak IPC. We can analyze this even further by looking at a program called Liquid. It allows us to measure the performance and also track the instruction mix. What are the instructions that we utilize? Some problems are easy to fix. For example, our summation example, we could run sum1 as before, we could run sum2 as before, but we can make this code even faster if we vectorize it and observe that we now are going to only utilize AVX floating point operations instead of running scalar operations one after another. So this allows us to break down the performance of our program by analyzing it in parts. The execution of our program depends on what instructions we use, how many of them are there, how expensive they are, and what's the frequency of a CPU. The cost of our instruction depends not only on the operation that it performs, but also on the memory access patterns. And the memory access patterns are going to be directly influenced by how well we utilize the cache and the memory hierarchy system. This is not the only metric we care about. Sometimes we care about minimizing power. And we can see that achieving higher number of instructions per second or instructions per cycle equivalently can also be of relevant. Sometimes racing to idle is a good power-saving strategy. Sometimes we care about traversing graphs. A very popular benchmark in the past was traversed edges per second. But we can see that this is not everything that is important for analyzing graph processing performance. In fact, memory locality, as well as the utilization of the memory bandwidth and how much information you can pack into one cache line in your graph algorithm, can determine the algorithm performance and make it or break it. Similarly, when you are processing network packets, sometimes those computations allow you to very quickly do a budgeting exercise so you can see what's possible and what's not. For example, if you would like to process network packets and 10 gigabit Ethernet line rate, you can compute that you only have 67 nanoseconds to process each packet. Now we know that if you have to access main memory, which takes over 60 nanoseconds, you will never meet the budget, and you will always be after the deadline. So it's actually a good idea not to look at this CPI metric as something that is set in stone that we have to take from textbook and follow by the letter. In fact, it's oftentimes better to think if you can come up with a metric that describes your particular problem and your particular application, because then you can do the budgeting analysis and the cost analysis that matters for you and the problem you are trying to solve. Now, we can see that the CPI itself also isn't a metric that is standing in isolation. It depends also on what is the cache utilization. In fact, if we had infinite cache, then the CPI would only depend on two components: how many cycles are we busy and how many cycles are we idle, for instance, waiting for a branch resolution. However, in practice, we have a finite cache, so this clock per cycle metric goes up. We have to pay it more and more, and the rate at which the cost increases depends on the misses per instruction. The more misses per instructions we have, the more the extra cost is going to be. The other cost that we pay, that also shows up in this vertical waste, are pipeline bubbles that correspond to mispredicted branches. We can also break down this misprediction penalty of a branch. It is never just the refill time of a branch. You sometimes read articles which tells you that on Sandy Bridge, the branch misprediction penalty is 14 cycles without any further explanation, but there is no such thing as the branch misprediction. There's only a family of branch mispredictions. They all have variable latency, and this latency depends on the program. In fact, over 50% of the branch penalty often depends on branch resolution time. So the natural question is, what does branch resolution time depend on? And this depends on how fast we can drain the instruction window, meaning at what is the rate at which the instructions can retire from the reorder buffer before you are going to resolve the branch. And the rate at which the instructions can retire from the reorder buffer is driven by a familiar metric, which we have seen by now, namely instruction level parallelism. So let's play with this a little bit. Let's have a simple branch misprediction example. We need some high latency operation, so we can look at trigonometric functions. These are always good for that. We can have a summation, which is going to either call the cosine function or a sine function, depending on a Boolean decision variable true or false. We can do this probabilistically, so we are going to use Bernoulli distribution, so we can not only control whether the branch is never taken or always taken, which are two extreme cases, 0 or 1, but we can also smoothly vary the probability of the branch takenness between 0 and 1. As we do that and as we run the benchmarks, first we can look at the extreme cases, never taken, always taken, and randomly taken. We could look at the performance metrics. We can look at the branch mispredictions rate. For example, for the never taken, the branch is predicted pretty perfectly. For the always taken, the branch prediction is again pretty much perfect. However, we have a relatively large branch mispredition rate for randomly taken. In fact, if we count the branch misses, we see that from 23,000 out of 374 million, in the never taken and always taken, we went up to 50 million mispredicted branches. It's a good idea when you do those experiments, when you compare those numbers, to run them multiple times. For instance, in perf, you can run a -r10 command, which is always also going to give you an interval, so you have some idea about the confidence and the variability of the timing that you are going to perform. Remember that whenever you have a intervals which overlap, you cannot meaningfully tell that one operation is more expensive than another. We can only tell something if we don't have an overlap in this uncertainty. But again, picture says 1,000 words, so it's better sometimes to just simulate this entire thing on a computer architecture simulator. One open source simulator is called Sniper. What it allows you is pretty cool. It actually allows us to see the CPI stack. We can see what are we paying for. So it's not just the base execution, the number of retired cycles, but also dependencies in the floating point computations. How much time did we waste for instruction fetch from memory? How much time did we spend on the access to the memory and L1 decache? And this is the never taken example. And then when I go to the always taken example, the proportions stay identical. And then when I go to the randomly taken example, you can see that there is a huge new component over here. This is the branch misprediction component. So what we can see from this already is that the predictable branches are essentially free. Mispredictable branches can be quite extensive. Looking at CPI stack also enables to see potential of optimizing something, because you can never optimize your program better than just removing the entire penalty component. So this gives you an upper bound of whether it even makes sense to optimize a given inefficiency in a given program. We can also track the execution of our program over time. For the never taken branch, we can see that in the beginning, before the branch predictor has warmed up, there were still a few mispredictions. It was similar for the always taken example, but it was quite much pronounced in the randomly taken example. We can also zoom up to have more detail, but the conclusion is the same. What essentially happens for the predictable branches like always taken or never taken is that those basic blocks separated by control flow dependencies like unknown branches essentially become glued together. So you can have one basic block, then a branch to another, and another, and another, and another. If all of those branches are predictable, the instruction scheduling at runtime done by the branch predictor and speculative execution in the CPU essentially glue them together. So what is a branch predictability? How can we know whether a branch is predictable or not? Is it takenness rate, like 50%? Is it transition rate, like 0011? We can compare the branches. For instance, looking at takenness rate, this is very close to randomly taken branch with 50% probability. We can also have a branch takenness pattern which looks like this, which is not taken, 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 not taken, taken, taken. We can also vary the takenness and not takenness by negating the conditions. We can vary the transition rates. What all of these have in common is they are all perfectly predictable. Branch predictor doesn't care about the transition rate. If it sees a pattern like 0101, then it can very quickly warm up to the state when this is a perfectly predictable pattern. Just as we can say as humans, when something is alternating between 0101, it's pretty sure not random. And if you would like to measure that, it's pretty good to measure only those branches, so don't measure the entire application, but use a liquid marker API, which allows you to only mark the code block that you are interested in, and only measure that. If we do that for our example, then we can see as we vary the probability of the branch misprediction, or the branch takenness in the random case, we see this pattern. So for the never taken branch and for the always taken branch, the penalty is essentially zero. However, for the branch which we take randomly 50% of the time, the penalty is going to be the highest one. We capture this in the so-called branch entropy metric, which essentially measures how irregular the branch is. However, when I say probability, I don't mean just any probability, but conditional probability. So normally, we would just count the takenness rate. How many branches were taken, which is the N1 metric, compared to the total number of branches. But remember, we want to capture patterns such as this. What was the takenness probability given the history of the branch like this? Or what was the takenness probability given the history of a branch like this? So that's the probability that we are going to use in the branch entropy metric. And if we do that, we can see that comparing this branch entropy to the branch misprediction miss rate, we have a pretty nice linear fit, which is mostly 1-to-1. So when you look at the branch predictability, you should really think about the branch entropy, which depends on the conditional probability of the branch. If it's something that is predictable, given history, then it's not going to be as costly. Now, we can also see that compilers sometimes introduce penalties by making certain expectation about which direction of the branch is going to be likely. For example, we could imagine going through a vector containing few integers, and depending on whether the integer is positive or negative, we are either going to store a number into one memory location or another. Then we can also perform the same exercise when we generate branches which are never taken, which are always taken, or which are randomly taken. And if we measure the performance, we are going to do this for both GCC and Clang. So we are going to measure the branches which are never taken, always taken, and randomly taken. GCC is going to be denoted with _G. Clang is going to be denoted with _C. What we can see here is that the timing for GCC reflects our intuition, meaning that the random branches are more expensive than the predictable always taken or never taken branches. However, we see something interesting in Clang. Notice that for GCC, we had this timing, which was 8 here and 8 here. However, for Clang, the never taken branch has a 9, and the always taken branch has a 7. So there seems to be an asymmetry in the penalty that we pay for each branch. So why is it? Now, we have those performance counters that we can use to analyze this in more details on a CPU. In fact, over time, we have gotten quite a lot of those performance counters. On latest Haswell and Broadwell Xeons, for example, there's around 1,600 of them. At each time, however, we can only utilize 8. Or if you are using hyperthreading, you can only utilize 4 per one logical thread. We would like to have some method, some methodology that drives us to tell which performance counters should we use if we would like to measure branch miss prediction, which performance counters should we use if we would like to measure function call overhead. And one nice idea is a top-down microarchitecture analysis method from Intel. There's also a great tool called PMU Tools by Andy Klein, which allows us to drill down into those metrics, starting from 4 basic categories. So we can be either front-end bound, which is, as before, things like mispredicted branches. We could be back-end bound, for instance, stalled on execution resources availability, stored on memory. We could also suffer from bad speculation, for instance, mispredicted branches, or if everything goes well and every operation completes successfully, then we are retiring. Retiring is good. We want a lot of operations which are retiring. So this essentially measures the bottlenecks in our CPU, dividing them into the front end and the back end of the processor pipeline, and allows us to focus on what is the problem we are trying to solve. We can also get the explanation for all of those metrics. There are some in the original article. You can also find this in the Appendix B of the Intel optimization manual. But remember, there's also a very nice way, especially if you're writing some automatic tool that gives you updated equations that you can even put in a spreadsheet in this address. So for instance, we can start first-level analysis with GCC, and we can see that we are mostly front-end bound. We can then move on to the second level, and as we do that, we can see that we are mostly bound in the front-end, and the reason is that the reservation station is empty. Remember, reservation station was the structure introduced in the out-of-order execution, which takes care of resolving the dependencies in the instruction data flow. Now, if we now look at this, we can see that there is one pretty cool option. Basically, we can ask PMU tools to show us the sampling command, which is going to give us a hint of what performance counters we can look at. For instance, there is a performance counter that tracks which cycles were suffering from the empty reservation station. So we can record this. We can use the perf command with record subcommand, ask this to use this exact counter, and after we record, we have a perf data, and then we can run the report. We can use the Intel syntax as well in perf. And in GCC, nothing is surprising. Indeed, we can see that this number 5 gets assigned to a certain memory address, which depends on a conditional branch. Now let's do the same thing for Clang. We can see that we are also front-end bound. We also need to look at reservation station. And here is the bet that Clang has made. It is actually assumed that only one branch direction is going to be taken more often. So what it has done is to aggressively optimize that direction and unroll the loop. This optimization paid off and made it faster in this taken direction, but it made it more expensive in the other direction. This is an example of something that we can find very easily using perf and PMU tools, but would not be easy to find just by looking at timing. We can also ask about the cost of virtual functions. Asking about cost of virtual functions is nothing else but asking about the cost of indirect branches. So let's look at a simple way to measure this. We have some function which is going to be returning integer. And depending on whether a certain branch is taken or not, we are going to return -1 or +1. And then, depending on whether we have returned -1 or +1, we are going to write a number into one memory location or another. So we can now couple the branch misprediction penalty, indirect branch resolution, and memory access. And real programs have usually those penalties coupled together. It's a good test for any performance analysis tools, whether we can throw them at a program that contains those coupled multiple microarchitectural events. So we run the same benchmarks. We do the Clang and GCC. And now we can see that the performance is a little bit asymmetric for GCC. There is a number 3 for the never taken, number 4 for always taken, and number 13 for random. For Clang, we have a very nice symmetric behavior for the never taken and always taken, and much faster execution of the randomly taken branch. Remember, we are comparing GCC's 13 with Clang 0.85, so it's about 1.5 times faster. So what happened? We run the same analysis starting from level 1. We already see that we are bound by bad speculation, mispredicted branches. We go to level 2. Again, we can see that we have the reservation station empty events and also the mispredicted branches. Now we can also go to level 3. This is going to give us a few more metrics. It's also going to notice that we have branch re-steers. And if we look at the GCC, we can see that now it has taken a bet where the code was placed a bit further in the memory for one direction of the branch, and this fetching of that code further corresponds to the higher branch re-steer penalty. In contrast, what Clang has done was fairly different. It has actually generated a predicated execution instruction conditional move. So conditional move is going to execute depending on whether a condition was true or false. What it does is essentially something we can analyze with an interactive disassembler, which also gives you the Intel architecture code analyzer. It converts the control flow dependencies into data flow dependencies. So we can see that if you have the branch in GCC, the code looks like this. You have this jump that is driven by a data which depends on the virtual function, and you have also this dependence on the data because you need to first write into the flags register and then read from the flags register to perform the jump. In contrast, if you have a predicated execution instruction like a conditional move, you only have this data dependence and you have gotten rid of the control flow dependence. There's a trade-off here because the latency of the conditional move itself can be higher than the move. However, if you are suffering from mispredicted branch, this can be a trade-off worth taking. You can control this from the compilers today by looking at the built-in expect function. You can base on that write macros likely and unlikely. Clang also has a pretty cool feature which allows you to make it inclined toward generating conditional moves. Remember that conditional moves offer a good payoff for unpredictable branches with short operation latency, so the built-in function is named appropriately built-in unpredictable. All right, so we can see that this penalty that we are paying for can show up here. Essentially, not only is the branch penalty depending on the window drain time, which depends on the instruction level parlance of the code that is around the mispredicted branch and the pipeline refill time, but also how fast we can refill the pipeline with instructions fetched after re-steering the branch from the correct address. And I think I'm going to be speeding this up because we are running out of time, so I'm just going to highlight you a few tools that you might use for your analysis. For instance, nice data visualization tool, also available, source tools available on GitHub. You can compare traversing vector, which you have nice contiguous memory access like this, with traversing a singly linked list, when you can see this pointer changing node after node after node, and doubly linked list, which you can also see the higher memory cost of the larger nodes. I can see that those costs are driven by the dependence in the memory access patterns where you need the previous address of a node of a linked list before you can get to the next node of a next of a linked list. So this is the same loss of the instruction level parallelism or analogous loss that we have seen when we used one register to some variables at a time, only now this is all amplified because those latencies that we pay are now memory access latencies. It's very easy if you analyze this in Radari, which is a pretty cool disassembler. It allows you to show you the control flow graph of your program. You can also see the basic blocks, and you can see that here you have this loop when for each traversal of the node that is next in the linked list, you first need to know the previous value of the pointer in that node before you dereference it and proceed further. You can see that the reason that the vector traversal is faster than the linked list traversal is that you can overlap more of the cache miss penalties, and the more those cache miss penalties you overlap, the higher your memory level parallelism is, and the lower the branch, excuse me, the lower is the memory access penalty. You can also speed this up by using prefetching. For instance, instead of just storing the pointer to the next node, you can store pointers to several nodes apart. You can then prefetch the addresses from those nodes. Be careful to calibrate your prefetch so that it is timely and doesn't waste memory bandwidth. You can also take the prefetch overhead into account, measure whether the prefetch is useful or not by looking whether it reduces the ratio of the cache misses. You can also emulate traversing the list and the vector on a computer architecture simulator. Observe that you can overlap the vector iterations, even several of them, but traversing just one creation of a list looks like this, 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 and this. And the reason it looks like that is that actually when you allocate a new node in the list, you are actually traversing another linked list, which you have in the malloc allocator. This malloc allocator you can also debug in Radari. You can see that as you call operator new and operator delete, you're actually creating a linked list that stores the chunks of the available memory on the heap. Delete is nothing else but unlinking those chunks, and allocating is nothing else but utilizing the already created chunks. Of course, if you do it a lot in the loop, you are going to suffer from memory fragmentation, and you are going to increase the cache miss penalties even further. All right, so I think I'm out of time. One more tool, which is pretty awesome, is PIN. I just have to show you, because this is pretty amazing. You can actually track all of the memory access patterns, printing out every memory access that you have addressed with every instruction address executed over time. And if you compare unfused loops with fused loops, you can even see what is the difference between the reads and writes executed in one loop after another versus the reads and writes executed together in one fused loop with fully overlapped latency. All right, that would be all. The final message would be pretty much is that as we move to phase two, we should think about all of the layers of the transformation hierarchy and be ready to break them. Because understanding all of them allows us to analyze performance and know what to do when something goes wrong. And as a matter of fact, it's a nice idea perhaps to consider that we shouldn't divide ourselves into software persons and hardware persons, but instead try to understand both sides of the equation. What is the hardware doing when we run our applications, and how to best construct hardware that can solve the problems faced by existing application developers. That would be all. I can recommend 3 resources. Thank you for coming to my talk. Let me know if you have any questions.